Kính thưa ngài giáo sư.
Professor Klaus Schwartz, Executive Chairman of the World Economic Forum, distinguished delegates, ladies and gentlemen. Representing the Vietnamese government, I would like to warmly welcome international and national organizations, enterprises, and students and youth representing the young generation of Vietnam to come here to attend the Open Forum ASEAN 4.0 for all, how to enable startups to seize opportunities generated by the fourth industrial revolution. I am very honored and privileged to welcome Professor Joab, the founder and executive chairman of the World Economic Forum, one of the major and pioneering economists who devoted a lot of determination and intellectual on the fourth industrial revolution. And he is the author of the book called The Fourth Industrial Revolution, the theme of our open forum today. Ladies and gentlemen, we are witnessing that the world is trying to develop integration and cooperation based on the fruits of science and technology, particularly the technologies by the fourth industrial revolution. It has dramatically changed the societies, changed each country, including Vietnam and other ASEAN member countries. Grasp opportunity, identifying the challenges is what we should do, and it is the shortcut and effective roadmap for us, and that we also need to select the national strategies and guidelines to narrow the gap between countries. And also we should bring into full play different opportunities to turn challenges into opportunities and to turn initiative into products and to reap success in the journey of innovation and startup. Over the years, the Vietnamese government has identified that enterprises, including startups, as the center of socioeconomic development, of innovation, as a force to develop the economy. And also the Vietnamese government has played an active role in further promoting Industry 4.0. As of now, we basically completed the building of the National Incubation Center, and we, for the first time, attracted the attendance and participation of startups and enterprises based on our efforts and strategies. Ladies and gentlemen, distinguished delegates, under the Open Forum of World Economic Forum on ASEAN today, we would like to propose that we need to discuss ways and views to foster cooperation among ASEAN countries and between ASEAN and global partners to turn Southeast Asia into a center for innovation and startup. We should play a leading role in exploiting the fruits of the Industry 4.0 to further promote socioeconomic development, how to make all of those countries smarter and more effective. We want to have more candid dialogues, and we wish to receive support from leaders, experts, enterprises of World Economic Forum in general, and His Excellency Professor Schwab in particular, in seeking out different solutions. And we should also further promote the cohesion among ASEAN countries to grasp opportunities and to seek solutions for challenges. Distinguished delegates, ladies and gentlemen, the Vietnamese government is developing the strategy for innovation and startup. And we also develop different scenarios for the fourth industrial revolution. In the implementation process, Vietnam wishes to cooperate and to join hands with the World Economic Forum and ASEAN to enhance the connectivity. And we are ready to provide our resources to join hands with other partners. I would like to take this opportunity to introduce all of you to participate in the biggest event of the innovation and startup community of Vietnam, Tech Startup, organized in Da Nang from November to the 1st of December 2018 under the theme Innovation and Startup. in the fourth industrial revolution, global integration process. Let's join hands together to build up a community of innovation and success. I wish the conference every success. I wish this open forum the first of many, many events under World Economic Forum every success. Thank you very much.
Minister Chu Nok An, thank you very much for those opening remarks, and Professor Schwab, thank you as well. Now we will turn the session into a panel discussion where we have many esteemed speakers to share their views with you on how we translate this fourth industrial revolution into an inclusive, human-centered, prosperous future. The theme of the discussion is ASEAN 4.0 for all. And the idea is that we want to be able to embrace these technologies and turn them to the benefit of society, and as Professor Schwab mentioned, to use and to harness entrepreneurship and all of your entrepreneurial ambitions to build a better, more prosperous and inclusive society. So to moderate and chair the next part of the program, I'm delighted to welcome Amrita Chima from Deutsche Welle, who will be overseeing the second part. And perhaps also the panelists can also join on the stage as Amrita comes as well. Thank you.
Hello, and a very warm welcome to you. Thank you very much, Justin, for that introduction. May I also thank Minister Chu Nok An for his very insightful comments and a warm welcome that you've given us to your country. Thank you also for your hope and optimism that the fourth industrial revolution will be a force for good for your people and the people of ASEAN, and a determination to make ASEAN a hub of innovation. Thank you also for telling us about your vision for your own country, Vietnam, the 2035 vision. Now, as you're the Minister of Science and Technology, I'm sure all the students will be very encouraged to hear your words. May I also thank Professor Klaus Schwab. You described the minister as a driver of the fourth industrial revolution. Now, Professor Schwab is the founder and the chairman of the World Economic Forum. Now, it was very good to hear in your own words, Professor Schwab, your vision of the fourth industrial revolution. Now, it was a term that you coined yourself. You've written a book on the fourth industrial revolution, which came out in 2016. And as a special gift to all the students who are here, Professor Schwab has brought 1,000 copies of this book in Vietnamese so that you can read it for yourself. Give him a big hand for that. Now, as we heard, Professor Schwab has talked about the huge opportunities that the fourth industrial revolution offers to society in general, but also it has a transformative effect in our lives, not, as he said, what we do, but who we are. And Professor Schwab, if I may say so, one of the quotes that I found most interesting in your book was, we have to ensure that the fourth industrial revolution is empowering and human-centric, and not that it is divisive and dehumanizing. Because I think there's a lot of discussion about how technology is going to change our lives, but you have insisted and you want to ensure that all the technology that we are getting is for the benefit of humankind, and not that we become slaves of the machines, but we master the machines to serve us. So thank you very much for sharing your vision with us. And ladies and gentlemen, as Justin said, I'm Amrita Chima, and it's my great pleasure to welcome a panel to discuss some of the issues raised by the minister and by Professor Schwab, and to see how we navigate the opportunities the fourth industrial revolution has to offer, but also to manage potential risks. One of them, as Professor Schwab mentioned, is maybe the loss of jobs. How do we navigate that? So to discuss that, let me begin by introducing our panel to you. On my left is Yasmin Mahmood. She's the CEO of Malaysia Digital Economic Cooperation. Now, she began in a very humble role as an analyst and a programmer. Then she was CEO of many companies before she said in 2014 she got a national calling to join MDEC. So a warm welcome to you, and we hope to hear more about what this national calling was. Next to Yasmin is Rajan Anandan. He is from Google, Managing Director, Southeast Asia and India. Now, Southeast Asia and India are the fastest growing region in terms of internet usage, 500 million. Now, so obviously, Rajan, you're in the right place, but because he's a manager responsible for sales and operations, he's not satisfied with that. He wants to expand even more, expand what he says is the internet ecosystem, and accelerate innovation. Now, I grew up with Google, and I thought Google existed all my life, but it's just 20 years old. Last week, you celebrated your 20th anniversary. Congratulations to the company for that. Now, next to Rajan, we have Honorable Saddiq Abdul Rahman. He is the Minister of Youth and Sports of Malaysia. Now, he's described in the internet as a politician and an activist. I like the description. Now, you're the youth chief of the Malaysian United Indigenous Party, Bersatu. You were elected and became a minister in July. And I heard rumors that Prime Minister Mahathir's election was a lot to do with your support as well. You got the youth vote. Now, you also, many of the young students might know him. He's a champion debater. He won Speaker of Asia 3 times in a row. But what some of you may not know, that he rejected scholarships to Oxford twice. Not Oxford didn't reject him, he rejected Oxford. Now, as a graduate of Oxford, I'm not trying to take this personally, but you are the youngest member in Malaysia since the country's independence. Now, you have said that your aim is to empower the youth and lower voting age from 21 to 18. We'll hear more about that later. Next to Saddiq is Annie Koh. She's a professor of finance from Singapore Management University. She has many portfolios, including in the Office of Business Development, International Trading Institute. She's on the board and advisor to many companies, including, which is interesting for us, GovTech Singapore at the Skills Future Committee. Now, she has an interesting thing she said. Everyone can embrace digital as our new sixth sense. And that is an interesting concept, that we have 5 senses, but digital could become our sixth sense. We have that potential, is what Professor Annie Koh has to say. And finally, we have a local star for all of you. We have Lee Hong Min. He's the CEO and a co-founder of VNG Corporation. He said I shouldn't call him a star, but he is an entrepreneur and a startup entrepreneur from Vietnam. His story is compelling, it's fascinating. Maybe he'll share some insights with us. But he did become fascinated by gaming at the age of 15 and went on to set up his own organization, which has expanded hugely. He's also moved into other internet portals in the Zing category, and one of them is ZingMe, which was the most popular social media platform before Facebook took over. But you have another one called Zing Alo, which is a bit like WhatsApp. So I think a lot of you young people would know these Zing Alo, ZingMe and things. He's the man behind all of that. So ladies and gentlemen, please give a warm welcome to our panel, first of all.
Thank you.
Okay, now what we're going to do is I'm going to start asking questions, but you also have a job to do. How many students here? Raise your hands. How many of you are students here? Raise your hands. That sounds like too few. I see many students. Okay, wonderful. A huge majority of students here. Thank you for raising your hands. So the thing is that I'm going to be asking them questions. You listen carefully to what they are saying, and then I'll ask you to ask questions. Because this is a fabulous opportunity for you, for these people here, to share their expertise with you. So remember, write down questions or think of questions you want to ask, and then we, at a later stage, I'll ask you to ask the questions. Let me start with you now, Aniko. You're a professor, and all these people are students here, so they're used to hearing professors. Do you think, Annie, that ASEAN and the region is prepared to embrace the fourth industrial revolution?
Thank you, Amrita, and a good morning. I love it. I love a room full of students. And of course, we are all young on this panel, right? We are young at heart. Now, the reason why we are here is we are actually very excited about the fourth industrial revolution. And I think it's not just because it's youthful, you know, nation in Vietnam, but all of us believe that the fate of ASEAN is in your hands. It will be in the hands of our young people across the 10 countries in ASEAN. And I like to think of it as the four eyes. 2 years ago, I spoke in Malaysia, and I spoke very, very poignantly about the issue of having an ASEAN identity. And I call this the soft side. I think we talk a lot about digital, and we talk a lot about, you know, technology. But at the heart of ASEAN is the ASEAN way, but at the same time identifying with ASEAN. So I would like to see cross-cultural movement. I'd like to see a lot more exchange between students across the 10 countries. And that's how we build identity. The next I, and I think Minister spoke about it very powerfully, is innovation. We need to unlock the enormous entrepreneurial skills within ASEAN. The young ASEAN countries, all of you represented in this room, I've seen some of the great technological advancements coming out, not from the more mature countries in ASEAN, but from the younger ones. And through technology, you could leapfrog. You could actually not be inundated with legacy. The third I, to me, is very important. It's about inclusiveness. I think the more we have technology, the greater the digital divide. And so while I wrote about having the sixth sense of digital skills, there are still many people within ASEAN, within individual countries, that do not have access to healthcare, to payments, to financial accounts, and even to education. So I need the inclusiveness as the third eye. And my last eye is integration. I think we do not work hard enough. We need more hard work. Integration calls for working. Integration calls for champions. I need government champions, I need social champions, and I need corporate champions. And I think today, we have that in and on this panel. And if we work towards the four I's, I think we can actually happily galloped into the fourth industrial revolution.
Thank you very much, Annie. That was very interesting. Four eyes. I'm going to turn to Rajan now with the second eye, which is innovation. Now, you obviously are from a huge tech giant, Google. So what role does a company like Google play in spreading innovation in a region like ASEAN?
Yeah, first and foremost, great to be here. Good morning, everyone. I love coming to Vietnam. I think without question, of all the countries that I go to, it is by far the most entrepreneurial country. Everybody I meet is either an entrepreneur like Minh or has many businesses that they've started or is about to start one, which I assume is most of you in the room. So look, when it comes to the fourth industrial revolution, at the core of it is a digital economy, right? And when you think about ASEAN, the 10 countries combined, and the digital economy in ASEAN, it's actually quite sizable, growing very rapidly, but it's got enormous potential. So one way we look at sort of the digital economy is as a percentage of overall GDP. So if you look at digital economy as a percentage of overall economy in ASEAN, it's about 7%. China's at about 16%. The top five EU countries at about 25%. The US is at about 35%, right? So in terms of full potential of the digital economy in ASEAN, we've got about five times growth that we can achieve, and achieving that as an ASEAN, as a group of ASEAN countries, really is about making sure that we have one integrated digital economy. All right. So what does that really mean? I think it's very important to have free flow of data across countries. It's important to have seamless payments across countries, and finally for goods and services as well to move across these countries. Right. But all of that still won't actually help ASEAN achieve its full potential. The most important to address one of the concerns or issues that Professor raised, which is how do we make sure that humans win over machines is skills, right? And I think skilling is by far the single most important thing. And as a company, as Google, we've specifically focused on skilling. And skilling at all levels, right? For students, for developers, for entrepreneurs, and also small and medium businesses. And today, I wanted to take a minute on small and medium businesses. If you look at small and medium enterprises, SMEs, in ASEAN, they account for about 50% of all GDP in the region, and they account for 80% of all jobs in ASEAN are actually small and medium enterprises. And if you think about how will ASEAN capture the full potential of the digital economy, we believe that probably the single biggest lever or area that we should focus on is skilling these small and medium enterprises to be able to capitalize on the digital economy. And on that front, Amrita, I'm delighted to announce today that officially we are going to announce that as Google, we are committing to train 3 million small and medium enterprise owners and employees on digital skills by the year 2020. Wonderful. So across the 10 countries, we will commit to training and making sure that these small and medium enterprises, therefore, can really get the best out of digital and the fourth industrial revolution.
Oh, Rajan, that's wonderful news, especially given that, as you said, SMEs are the backbone of ASEAN member states. Turning now to you, Minister Saddiq, now you are obviously the youngest minister, as I mentioned, in Malaysia since its independence, and you're one of the youngest ministers in the world, I would think. Now, is there a great sense of excitement among the young people? You want to empower the young generation. Yep. Is there a great sense of excitement about these new technologies and the potential they have to offer?
There's definitely a great sense of excitement and also a great sense of concern. I think as the professor rightfully pointed out just now, there are also concerns about growing unemployment rates if we fully rely and we do not transition well. But at the same time, I believe the future is a lot more optimistic. While there are some who say that doors will be closed, the point in which we fully automate, the point in which artificial intelligence replace more conventional jobs. However, similarly, like what happened when spinning jenny was introduced during the first industrial revolution, while you replace one, there will be thousands more which will be created. When a computer came in, typists were replaced, but then you create computer engineers, IT software developers, and the rest. So I think, especially in ASEAN, when the youth population are very young, it's about 25 to 35 years old on average, I think the dynamism in which it provides, in which it brings, is very big. There are a lot of untapped potential. In Vietnam, for example, the entrepreneurial community is very big. In Malaysia, the youth community, which takes great interest in gaming, for example, acts as a precursor towards greater interest in IT and software development. And I believe the government or previous governments have been focusing on this. Even, for example, since 2001, we've been focusing on the creation of Cyberjaya. You know, we try our best to ensure that we have our own Silicon Valley. At the same time, we assist a lot of our young entrepreneurs to prepare for the fourth industrial revolution since 20 years, about 18 years ago. So I believe the future looks well, and the point in which young people partake in that change-making process, they equip themselves well. The drive to learn is a never-ending journey. I believe the youth will be prepared. But most importantly here, I think there must be great recognition of the youth potential which exists. And that's a unique part about the fourth industrial revolution. It takes out the age barrier, the age limit, which previously, or the conventional wisdom, is that if you are young, you are incapable, you are inexperienced. But when we see some of the best startups being started by young entrepreneurs, then it breaks stereotypes. It shows that young people are capable, but that due recognition must be given by the government, by corporate sectors, to ensure that in the end we can march forward and not just become leaders of tomorrow, but also shape the future today. And the fourth industrial revolution, I believe, will be shaped by my generation, and also the success of it will be defined on how governments today defined the current education policy, entrepreneurial policy, because if we fail today, then we'll be left far, far behind. If we look previously, There are some countries who unfortunately fall back when they simply do not accustom from the transition from an agrarian economy to an industrialized economy to a service-based economy. I believe ASEAN countries simply cannot take a back footing of this. We must be the leader of the fourth industrial revolution with great untapped youth potential. I believe we can do the impossible if we put our hearts and minds together. Thank you.
Ông Syed, ông đưa ra một cái quan điểm rất quan trọng. Chúng ta đã nói về những cái con người trẻ tuổi này sẽ là những cái nhà lãnh đạo tương lai. Họ đang có trong mặt trong khán phòng này, họ sẽ là những cái CEO, tổng giám đốc điều hành trong tương lai. Và chắc chắn là họ đang tạo ra tương lai ngay từ hôm nay. Và tương lai sẽ phụ thuộc vào tất cả các bạn. Đó là một cái quan điểm rất là quan trọng. Chúng ta hãy quay trở lại về cái quan câu hỏi bởi vì là cái câu hỏi này, thông qua câu hỏi này
thì... You talked about you had this high flying corporate career with lots of big companies as a CEO, and then you said you had a national calling to join the Malaysian Digital Economy Corporation. What was this national calling? Does it mean that you felt that you needed to shape and give direction to the digital sector in your country?
Yes, thank you. Good morning. It's a pleasure for me to be here. MDEC is a government agency, and it was started 20 years ago when there was a vision about this Malaysian, this multimedia super corridor, the MSC. At that time when it first started, I was a very young manager in a multinational, because I feel really old, by the way. I've been in the industry for 30 years. You know, when I was studying in school, in university, the power that you now have, the computing power that is now residing in your smartphone, actually took computers to fill, I would say, half of this room. And in the 30 years, I was a witness to the evolution, to the revolution that was driven by when Bill Gates said that there was his vision of one desktop on one computer on every desktop. When Steve Jobs unveiled his first Macintosh and the smartphone, when the internet first came on board. But right now, at this current junction, I have never been as excited yet. Also feel threatened with the impact of technology. And I really want to, you know, the whole 4IR concept really put it all together. And 4IR will be very much driven by AI, and much has been spoken about AI, and rightfully so.
AI being artificial intelligence.
AI being artificial intelligence, and because I truly believe that 4IR will be driven by the AI revolution. But if you combine the other things that's happening in the area of nanotech or neurotech, for instance, AI is fed through data, and data is through sensors from this IoT. Now, there is now technology and innovation about making sensors to the size of atom. So can you imagine, you can put sensors into bridges, sensors into even your human body. There is also this neurotech, which talks about how you can transfer your brain waves into computing, into signals that can be translated into computing, which means that you can literally be having this telepathic capability. So if you think about all that is happening, and you couple with the pace that Klaus spoke about, the pace of innovation, it took 75 years for the landline, for the phones to go to 100 million. It took the smartphones, the mobile phones, only 16 years. And it took the internet only 6 years. And you know what? Angry Bird took only 35 days to go to 50 million users. So the pace is going to be so phenomenal. So the question is then, how do we as a country, and I think many have already spoken about it, if left to its own organic dynamics, they will be the winners of this whole revolution. The winners would be, as if we were to compare with what happened when horse carriages were overtaken by cars. The winners were the car companies, but there were also a lot of losers. You know, there was horse riders who went out of job. So leaders of a country really make sure that it is an inclusive innovation, not just about developing the Amazons or the apples of the world who will be going to 1 trillion. They'll be at market cap of 1 trillion. In fact, Amazon alone, the market capitalization is equal to the 7 of the largest consumer, traditional consumer-based companies. So it is very important. It's only through government intervention. And I think many have spoken about skills. How do we prepare? And WEF is my favorite quote. WEF talks about 65% of our children who are going into schools right now will be coming out to jobs that don't even exist, jobs that are called drone traffic optimizers. You know, you wouldn't, cryptocurrency consultants. So I think this is where the role of the government needs to come in. And there is a lot of opportunity, but undoubtedly, this revolution, there will be short-term pain before there will be the long-term gain.
Good. So you're talking about governments must be involved, and that brings me to Lee Hong Min. The government was not involved in your enterprise at all. You are a startup entrepreneur, which I think almost everybody, has everybody here obviously heard of VNG Corporation. It was founded by Minh, and it was co-founded by Minh, and it was your idea. You have a fascinating story to tell. Minh, if everybody in this room from Vietnam knows you, but maybe they do not know how you began. Do you want to tell us how you started VNG Corporation?
Okay, so the room is full of students, and all I can say is you just play a game and you can start a company.
Okay. That's the short version. What's the long
version of it? And I think a longer version of it is, you know, I often said to my friends that we are the very lucky generation, because when I grow up and become a teenager in the early 90s, that when computer got introduced to Vietnam, and then also a little bit later then internet got introduced to Vietnam. So we are the generation that look at the computer and the internet and say, wow, you know, this is something so amazing. Mm-hmm. You know, you can just make things happen. You can play games, you can, you know, connect to people that are not sitting in the same room. And right now, for all of you in this room, that concept seems very trivial, right? You know, it's you know, so normal. But then 20 years ago, in my generation, when we grew up, be able to sit and wait for a dial-up computer, like 10 minutes to connect to the internet, and then like you go to a forum and you type something and someone respond to you, that magical. So that's how our generation grew up. And then it's very natural for us to say, you know what, this is going to happen in a significantly impactful way, and everybody going to do it. So let's build a career, let's build a company out of it. So in a way, many of the things that you think magical today going to become normal 20 years from now, mm-hmm. Right? So I'm not sure, like, you know, what you think is magical, but then I think it's pretty magical if you ask the computer something, and it can answer you in a very natural kind of way. I mean, like Google just demoed something in the Google I/O a few months ago, right? And even, you know, we are in a tech community, we understand that that's a demo, which means that, you know, it has to be prepared very well, and then still, it gives you a sense of magical wonderment. Similarly, I mean, like, you know, 2007, when Steve Jobs introduced the iPhone, and for us in the industry, we understand that is one of the magical moments. So the comeback thing is like, you know, you sitting in this room, I mean, I'm trying to address these students, right?
Yes.
And you're hearing all these big talks, and you may not understand a lot of them. I mean, sorry, I'm just trying to be practical, that my job.
I agree.
And the point being is, think about 20 years from now, just like us 20 years ago. Because that's your future. That's something that you're going to build, hopefully, you know, the next billion US dollar company out of Vietnam or out of Asia. And do the thing that right now, don't focus on a thing that is normal, right? You're having a smartphone on your pocket. you all can connect with thousands, or maybe, you know, some of you may have hundreds or thousands followers similar to you know, the minister here on social network. But all of that is normal today. Don't do the normal stuff, right? Because the future happening with something today you think is magical, something today you think is unimaginable. Mm. And that's how things normally work, right? Don't believe, I mean, sorry again, I mean, don't believe in all the things that we the people say, because we just say the thing that we understand today, right? And maybe we say something that serves our own interests, right? Mm-hmm. Think about your interests. Think about what something that really makes you excited. And that I think that's something going to be cool for you in the next 20 years. Hopefully, you know, World Economic Forum going to give you an interview in the stage and say, like, you know, how you start. So that's my long story, sorry.
Oh, that's wonderful. If I may just add to the story, now all of your students, what he didn't tell you that he was passionate about gaming when he was 15 years old. 15 years old, and you know, at that time, parents are always telling their children, go and study and stop all this gaming and things. But he was passionate, and then he went to the World Cyber Sport in Korea.
Cyber game, yeah.
Cyber games, and then was completely taken by the idea. And that was the seed of VNG Corporation that you see today. Now, how many of you would like to become a startup entrepreneur like Minh? Students, all of you who are listening, how many of you would raise your hands high so I can see them? Okay, so quite a few of them are impressed with your story, short and long, Minh, and they would like to be like you. So
okay, can I ask a question? How many of you would like to be a minister on the age of 25 like him? Raise your hand.
See, I'm in trouble.
Politician. How many of you? Okay. They want to be born to be politicians.
So they want to be both, Minh. All right, they want to be an entrepreneurial minister at 25.
So, okay, so I think that more of the students here want to be politicians, young politicians, than to be a young startup. Sorry about that, Minh. Okay, now, do any of you have questions? Does anyone want to raise a hand and ask a question of any of the panelists? We have people with microphones who can come back to you. Okay. Okay, do I see a hand there? No, I don't.
There's one there.
No. Raise your hand and stand up if you can, because it's difficult to see just a little hand.
You know, in my university, we always tell the students, don't be afraid to ask questions, because that one question from you, many other people are also hoping to ask.
Do you see a hand?
I see. Yeah, I can see.
Oh, yes, I see. The gentleman there, can we take a microphone?
See, I tell you.
Yes.
Why don't you stand up so he can bring the mic
in? Yeah, just stand.
And if you just tell us your name, and obviously you can speak in Vietnamese, and we have headsets, so we'll be able to listen.
Yeah, I speak English. So I speak English, so...
Okay.
I want to speak English. So my name
brilliant.
Is... My name is Quyen. I'm from Hanoi University of Science and Technology. So I heard... Frau Chima, Mr. Saddiq, talk about the what the young people talk about the adaptation to be able to prepare for the future. Well, I know history has been proven that new technology creates more jobs than it reduced. But I want to ask you guys, what do the young people should or must do to be able to adapt for the new era, or what do the other people, like the unadaptable individuals, have to do to be able to find jobs to be able to work in the future? So that's my question. Thank you.
Okay, should I ask Minister Saddiq, do you want to answer that question?
Yeah. Firstly, thank you very much. It's a great question. I have a different strategy there. I don't believe that young people should just adapt. Mm. If it's about adaptation, I'm pretty sure I wouldn't be here today. Mm. Because adaptation means you conforming to the convention. And convention, unfortunately, usually underprivileges young people because of the fact of age and experience. My suggestion for the youth of ASEAN is for you to think out of the box, to ensure that you do beyond the normalcy and the unique part with the introduction of the fourth industrial revolution, as we're going to a more tech era, a more digital-based economy, these are our areas of expertise. I agree with my colleague. Find your passion. We all have our own passion. Some of you might want to become politicians. Some of you want to become young entrepreneurs. Some of you want to have your own unique tech startup. And once you identify that passion, while you must, you know, learn from those with great experience, but always think 10 steps ahead. Always look what your generation or our generation will demand for the next 20 years. Because if you start up and you follow, you conform and you follow the convention, there will be thousands or tens of thousands of people who will be ahead of you who started earlier. But the unique part when you are young, usually we are risk takers. When you are young, you have that great enthusiasm and that ever-burning passion in you. Find that ever-burning passion, push all the way, and use the most unconventional means to achieve that at times conventional outcome. And I believe that if we are able to do so, and if every single young person taps into their own passion and potential, I believe we can do miracles. So I hope that helps. Thank you.
Can I jump in, Amrita?
Sure.
Yeah. So, you know, I'm not young like the minister, and he's a rock star. Okay, but I'm employee number 18 in my university, and my university is only 18 years old. So what happens is we have to keep innovating, even as a university. And I love that question. I don't think you want to be confining yourself, just like what Saddiq said. But what you could do is build your capabilities. And I think in science and technology, that's digital, there's a lot of things in science. But even in the arts, I'm an economics grad, then I moved to finance. Even in econs and finance, you could also build your domain. So that capability is very important. But at the same time, you must build your cultures. I think regional culture, knowledge and awareness of ASEAN, it's not in your curriculum, but you are connected. You are connected from day one. Most of you in this room are born in the year 2000. 18 years old in the year 2000 are already digital from birth. So you are already connected digitally. So build that culture. But the last one, build the communities. I think Minh is where he is because he had a community. He has an ecosystem. So a lot of your learning is not confined to classroom. A lot of your learning is outside of the classroom, in connecting with the community and sensing where the future will lead you.
Thank you, Annie. I think we have a question. I saw a hand up from a lady there in the middle. Did anyone raise a hand there?
Can you stand up?
I see a lady at the back there. Can you stand up, please? Yeah. Can you stand up?
I think there's a gentleman
here. Yeah, because it's easier to see you. Did you have a question? Yes, please stand up.
There's someone.
There's one, there. There's one more there.
Yeah, a lady.
Yeah. Okay. Good. There's one behind her as well. Okay.
Just can I ask Mr. Amadam, the chief executive of Google in Southeast Asia and India, a question that is, you have said that you like Vietnam, and I want to ask why Google don't have an official department or office in Hanoi, which is a very a place that have very young innovators and talent in here, because I promise with you that my country, especially in Hanoi, we have so many of them compared to other countries in Asia.
Google,
thank
India.
You.
Yeah.
So that's for you, Rajan. Actually, 3 million training jobs.
First time they've clapped. First time they've clapped. Yeah, you know, I think it's a great question. So I think first and foremost, Vietnam is an extremely important country for Google, right? Because of a number of reasons, right? One, it's got a large number of internet users, over 50 million internet users. Secondly, it's an extremely dynamic internet ecosystem. There are more small businesses and entrepreneurs that use the internet and leverage the internet to grow their businesses here than actually most other countries around the world. And so what we've been really focused on, you know, the way we approach any specific country is to take things in phases. So first we want to make sure that all our products work very well, right? Whether it's Android, search, YouTube, mail, and so on and so forth. Second, we want to make sure that we address some of the biggest barriers to getting citizens of a country online. So whether it's access with things like Wi-Fi, whether it's providing lots of support for ecosystem developers and so on and so forth. And then the last step really is for us to have an on-the-ground presence. So this is something that we have been in discussions with the government for quite some time on. And there's a number of things that need to come together in terms of policies and regulation and so on and so forth that will enable that. So we are extremely excited about Vietnam, and we look forward to obviously making sure that all of you, I think the most important thing for us as Google is to make sure that all of you work for yourselves and you become amazing entrepreneurs, which really is what today is about, right? And I think the way you should think about Google is how can you really get the best out of Google so you build the skills and the tool sets and the capabilities to build the next Google or to build the next VNG.
I'll make it difficult for you. So when exactly you're going to open the office?
That's the spirit. That's the spirit.
Great question, Min.
Loves competition.
Okay, I saw another hand of a woman up there. Or is anyone this side? Do we have?
There's
okay, we have a lady there in a black jacket. Can we take the microphone? Yes.
Yeah, let us.
Oh, sorry, in a pink blouse.
I'm Ling. I come from Transformation and Communicate University, and I have a question for you. Nowadays, the explosion population is a serious problem, so can you talk more clearly about what pressure on us, on the young people who want to get a job?
Sorry, your question was what pressure is there on young people when they get a job?
Yes.
Okay. Yasmin, do you want to take that question? What pressure is on young people when they get a job?
I think the question is because of the fourth industrial revolution, what is the pressure on the young people when they go out and get a job?
Yeah. Okay. I want Yasmin to answer that question because you know she's been through a lot herself and began as a young programmer and then she's risen to all these things. So what are the pressures?
So let the auntie take the question. I let it translate first. Nobody's laughing, okay. So, you know, this when I spoke just now about the fact that in this whole revolution, there will be those who would be disrupted and there will be those that will be disrupting. So the chances are that those who are already in the workforce, you know, like in manufacturing, people who have already they're already very set in their skill set and are not willing to get reskilled, those will be for sure will be disrupted. But the potential disruptors will be the young people. Yeah. So the question is, what can young people do right now? Now I want to talk about this thing. Ming talk about magic. Yeah, magic. I am a computer science and applied maths graduate, so I am a science geek from young. I love physics in school. And I remember that the one thing that has taken me across, and that is why I am still relevant as an auntie, is because of the curiosity. Yeah, because I remember watching the TV. I came from a small village in Malaysia, and we didn't have a TV in our home, but we had a TV in our neighbor's home. And I remember watching the TV, and I was so upset about not understanding how the little people can appear on that screen. So I wanted to study it. I wanted to understand it. Now, what is worrying to me right now is if you young people, when you study in schools or in university, and you only, you know, it's a degree is the end, not the means to an end. So if you don't have the curiosity, if you look at the phone and you just enjoy it as a consumer, and you don't have that curiosity to understand the magic behind it, and only when you understand it, then you can start creating, you can become producers of innovation as opposed to just, you know, just enjoying it. So that curiosity, I think, is what's going to make you, because technology is going to change. What you learn today in school is not going to be relevant 2 years even, 3 years down the road, right? So that curiosity to learn is something very, very important.
Yeah. Let me quickly ask a question. How many people in this room are studying marketing? Raise your hand. Like marketing, no one?
I saw one or two.
There's one over there.
Okay.
This side.
Okay. So just give you an example of what pressure you're going to face in this so-called Industry 4.0, right? Because it's actually happening. So, and thanks to Google. Sorry, I can't, like, you know, make
they're really lobbying for this, you know.
Yeah.
Thank you, yeah, in between.
You know, about 5 years ago, then digital marketing is a very hot sector, right? Because you have to understand how to, you know, advertise a normal business online using Google and Facebook and a lot of digital marketing tools. And you can, and right now, as we speak, Google is making AI doing most of the job of a digital marketers, right? So before, let's say in VNG, then we have teams of people who have to design the campaign, who have to set up, like, you know, parameter, who have to do search engine optimization. We have to do so many things, right? Right now, it's magic, but basically we tell Google, we need this, and we have this much to spend. And Google AI figure out the rest. So basically, within a span of about 5 years, then a very hot sector in Vietnam become obsolete, right? So maybe a lot, I mean, like, not maybe, definitely, most of the thing that you are learning right now, not gonna have a lot of practical values. I'm sorry to say that. Right? But hopefully you're gonna learn some fundamental skill, right? So that you can continue to learn. So I think that the most difficult thing that you are facing right now is you have to continue to learn to do new things.
Yes.
There's not any fixed job in today's world. I mean, like, you know, at the moment, so we're looking at our marketing team, and it's totally different from 5 years ago, right? And then we're looking at kind of like, you know, what companies like Google have done, and we just think it's amazing. Amazing for business, amazing for Google, not so much amazing for the people who have done that job before. So that the pressure you are facing, and it's happening right now.
Thank you. I mean, Minh, when you started your company, which was in 2004, it was quite a lonely experience for you, from what I read. I read an interview you gave in 2012, and you talked about how the ecosystem for the kind of work that you were doing did not exist very much. But now this year, earlier this year in April, you were in Silicon Valley to connect with other people of Vietnamese technologists and to create an ecosystem for people here in Vietnam. Could we have a Silicon Valley in Vietnam, do you think?
I may have also another contrarian views on this as well, and maybe the government may not like what I say.
The minister is there. You can say directly face to face to him. You don't need an appointment.
You know, in business, right? So basically, a very common way of doing business is you look at what other people have done, and you say, okay, I'm going to copy that. I mean, copy is the word, right? So many people trying to become a Google, many people trying to become a Facebook, and so on and so forth. And how many of those people really be successful, right? You're not hurting someone saying that, hey, this guy is the second Google of the world. So in a way, if you think about innovation and you think about kind of like, you know, you're trying to do, I think the most important thing, I mean, yes, we would love to learn from Google. We love to learn from Silicon Valley. But you're not going to be successful learning from Google and saying that I'm going to build a second Google. In a way, many of the government trying to say, I'm going to build a Silicon Valley of Malaysia, of kind of like, you know, China or Vietnam. I'm sorry. I mean, like, you know, that's the truth. Yes, maybe that in an analogy way, that kind of like, you know, how you're gonna explain it for people to understand, but it's affect how we think about, you know, how to make innovation happen in our context. Mm-hmm. So what we thinking, I mean, right now as we speak, you know, we think, you know, even I come to Silicon Valley and talk to the Vietnamese communities there, I think that I should go here and open an office. Not the other way around, not asking those people to move back, because I said to them, you know what? Yep. You're living in one of the best places in the world. Mm-hmm. Who am I to ask you to move back? And who am I to ask to move back because you love your country? I mean, like, okay, thank you, but you know, you have your life to worry about, right? I'm very practical. So in a way, thinking about innovation is, again, my point being is how to make that happen within a context, right? And then right now the world, you know, in a way, I think the whole world is Silicon Valley. Innovation happening in any way, in any form. I mean, like, you know, you don't need to try to confine it within a geographic location, right? So the trick is to think about what problem you want to solve and how to mobilize resources from wherever possible to solve that problem.
Minh, you combine two very interesting elements. You always talk about being practical, but at the same time, you talk about magic. And I think that's a wonderful combination, being practical and yet having magic in your operation. Yasmin, you want to say something, but before we go to you, can I just put one piece of information towards you? We also put a poll on Twitter. We asked people, you know, a lot of people have concerns that with the fourth industrial revolution, a lot of jobs will be lost. So we put a poll up on Twitter. Do you think technology will create jobs or destroy jobs overall? We got about 3,000 replies within a space of a few hours, and a majority, 58%, felt the fourth industrial revolution would lead to the creation of jobs, 58%, and 42% said they would destroy jobs. So I just want to put that information out there. And Yasmin, yes, turning to you, what was would you like to
I
add?
I just wanted to add on a little bit more to what Minh was saying. And this is about the magic of Silicon Valley. It is true that Silicon Valley is the what I call the mothership of innovation. But we would be cautioned to emulate Silicon Valley as is. Because if you think about it, two facts that I always put forth. Number one is Silicon Valley hasn't been replicated in its in its totality anywhere in the world, not even in the US. So everybody has their own version. So we should look into what is organically the strength of a country and to build innovation ecosystem based on those strengths and not, you know, because if you say that we want to be the Silicon Valley of so-and-so, then I think it's almost saying that we're starting off, setting ourselves up for failure because Silicon Valley has not been replicated anywhere in the world. So that's number one. Number two is the question as to whether is the Silicon Valley footprint the best? And I think it's only half of the story because I was on a panel at The Economist a year ago and there was this question, is Asia going to win or is the US going to win in the race for innovation? And I put up and say Asia is going to win because if Asia is if winning means as a national win, then inclusivity has to be the key driver. And America is not inclusive at all. Silicon Valley has got these companies, they are $1 trillion in market cap. Mm-hmm. But if you go into Midland, if you go into the heartland of the US, you hardly see any adoption. You will still see entrepreneurs who have not embraced in totality, you'll see banks who are still very arcade. They're still very credit card driven as opposed to, e-wallet driven. So I think we need to be wary of the fact that Silicon Valley is only one component of it, but inclusivity is something that governments have to really focus on.
Okay, so I mean, be inspired by Silicon, but don't copy it is the message I'm hearing. Okay, I want to ask you, I told you about this Twitter poll. The majority thinks the fourth industrial revolution would lead to the overall, more people felt it would create jobs. What do you here in this room think? Raise your hands, the people who think that the fourth industrial revolution will create jobs. How many people think it'll create jobs? And you have to raise your hands high because otherwise we can't see them because all of you are wearing white shirts. Okay. Wow. Okay. So the whole panel thinks it will create jobs. And how many think it will lead to a loss of jobs?
It will too.
Okay, both. Now that is very interesting. Okay, Saddiq, since you are our youngest panel member here, I want to ask you, obviously you're very keen that the young people will profit from this digital economy. But every time there's big change, people get left behind.
Yep.
Now, you as a youth minister, how do you feel? What would you do to engage that people don't get left behind in what is described as a digital divide sometimes?
Firstly, the reason why I believe young people benefit the most because the majority of disruptors are indeed young people. Mm. So while there are job losses, it's expected in next 2 decades about 50% of the jobs today can be automated or replaced with AI. That's a huge number. But the same concern was also there during the first or the third industrial revolution. But the job creation after is a lot more and a lot more tech-specific and high-skilled. The concern which I have is access to education in the next 20 years. Why do I say this? With the fourth industrial revolution, you'll see the specifications or the specialization needed in order for you to get that job will increase. Because repetitive jobs can easily be automated and can be replaced. Ones which cannot are ones which require high critical thinking, creative thinking, and also greater specialty like in nanotechnology and the rest, which means that the time taken to educate that person will also increase. And if you look, since the 1800s, back then, you don't need a very coordinated studying module. The time taken to study is also a lot less. As time passes by, it takes 1 year, 2 years, 3 years, now even 4 to 5 years in universities. And imagine with greater specializations, that time will also increase. Therefore, the cost barrier will increase as well. However, while I say that, the unique part about the fourth industrial revolution, we cannot imagine what the world will look like in the next 20 years. I'm very sure when spinning jenny was introduced and replaced the cotton industry, a lot of people didn't know that in the end, a lot more jobs will be created. Because from there onward, there's a trickle down to greater communities, access to those jobs increase as well, greater technology and the rest. So similarly, when I talk about education, so while you may seem, well, the time taken for education will increase, therefore the cost will increase as well. But now you see education being digitized as well. The cost of education becomes cheaper when it is digitized. You have digital universities, you have free courses you can take up online. And now a lot of unnecessary skill sets are being phased out, therefore you are only taught what is needed to you. So in a way, I believe, almost everyone I talk to have that concern, especially in Malaysia, because again, when young people, we were a very young country, when young people enter the job market, they haven't specialized yet, then their skill sets can easily be replaced. But while that is true, I think the next 20 years with VR, genetic editing, a lot of technologies in which we could never ever expect to take place in this era, there will be that development and the expansion will increase. And I believe, naturally, the inclusivity will also come with it as well, especially with a more equitable government, a government which cares and takes great interest in protecting the needs of young people. The reason in the Malaysian context why I'm very optimistic is because, firstly, we're a very young population. At the same time, the youth population is very big, and especially if you reduce the voting age, it'll become bigger. Mm-hmm. So in the end, when the youth becomes the future, governments, corporate entities must cater to their demands in order for the nation to progress. So while there are concerns, and these concerns are indeed legitimate, I think the benefits in which we will gain will be much larger, because not only are the benefits which we can see today, but the unimaginable benefits which will come in the next 20 years. Similarly, what we could not have foreseen when spinning jenny was introduced, when the computer and internet was introduced, I think there will be a greater benefit which we have not seen today, but will see in the future.
See, Malaysia is a good example because you are the youth minister and then you have a prime minister, Mahathir Mohamad, who's the oldest leader in the world. So you have both ends of the spectrum there. Where I think, and what I would also suggest to all our young student friends, you're all very, of course, savvy and clever with technology. But do also discuss and help your mothers and your fathers and your grandmothers and your grandfathers so they also stay in touch with technology. My mother is 85. And she's completely, with iPhone and iMessages and WhatsApp and everything, she does all that. I'm learning from her more than she's learning from me. So I think you must make sure that your generation of your parents and your grandparents don't get left behind as we make progress in digital technology. Now, okay, time for one of you to ask a question.
A question back there,
gentleman in a white shirt.
A lot of people. Hello, everybody. My last name is Paige. I have a comment and I have a question. The comment is, you actually don't want Google to come here. It means they've cornered the market. And the question is for the government officials. The EU had just passed a very important law, a regulation called the General Data Protection Regulation, which protects us from Google and Facebook. So, the government officials, what are you doing to protect your populations against the seeping intrusiveness of Google into our, into your population's lives? Thank you.
It's too specific.
For the government, well, you are the one.
I have a contrarian viewpoint. Trust me, I'm not being paid by Google. So I believe data should be as open, transparent, and accessible as possible. Not only because data sharing or the transparency of data alone will allow for small companies to then climb up a lot faster in comparison to having monopolies or oligopolies. But at the same time, in the world which we are living today, the interconnectedness of the world adds a great value to all of us. It allows for specific advertisement, which then benefits a specific community. It allows for people or for corporations to target or to cater to the demands of specific communities, not on random, but what those communities demand for. But most importantly, what I care about is to allow for small countries or to climb up or to catch up with the European giants. I believe that since, I mean, I follow quite closely the additional regulations placed in European countries based on data protection, I believe that will be one of the stumbling blocks in Europe, especially when you see Chinese companies in China, which has open data, or at least among their own respective communities, then being able to tap a huge market and a bigger market, if not in Europe, then in ASEAN, in other parts of the world, and their companies having a greater advantage and leverage over European giants. But I'm not just looking at China, I believe then they will face their own problems as well. But then we will look back at countries like Malaysia, Singapore, Vietnam, in which these concerns are not the greatest of concerns, which then gives greater room for these respective startups and companies to expand. Data protection is important, but overzealous regulation in the long run will hurt the development, especially of small and medium enterprises and tech startups, which already place at a great disadvantage because they don't have the capital like the more bigger industries. But I believe that in the end, having greater access to data and at the same time data transparency and sharing of that data allows for small, medium enterprises and for developing countries to tap into a market which they've never had the opportunity to tap into before. Thank you.
But at the same time, I agree, all right, with Saddiq, but I think that's the reason why we have an open forum. I think ASEAN is nicely sitting and an opportunity here. I think amongst all the 10 countries, if we could come together and discuss how do we set in place data governance so that people could trust the data that we are sharing across the 10 countries, then I think we at least have a great pilot and we could say that, you know, data can be shared, but shared within certain guidelines and protecting the individual, the companies. So we don't want to stunt the growth, but I think we have the capacity to come together. And that's why I was very excited because 3 months ago in SMU, we started the Data Governance Center, which was funded by the Economic Development Board and the private sector. So I think today's world, we need public-private partnership, not in just fixed assets or infrastructure, but in digital assets and digital structure. I think we have a chance as a region.
Rajan, do you want to add anything?
Yeah, no, I think a couple of thoughts just building on this. I think when it comes to privacy, consumer privacy is incredibly important, right? And I think the most important thing for a consumer is to have control of his or her own data. Right? You should be able to control what data is captured, how that data is used, and the minute you want to delete all data that a platform has, whether it's Google or other platforms, you should have that ability to do, right? And where we are today is actually we have that We've created that ability. So if you can go to Google, I'm just speaking specifically about Google because the comment was on Google. You can go to Google My Settings, and actually we share with you as a user all the data that we have about you. And you can decide to completely delete the data. You can decide to take that data, port it to a different platform, and so on and so forth. Right? So I think from a privacy standpoint, this idea that as a user, you control your data is paramount. Right? And then we need to obviously be custodians of that data and give you the choice that you need, that whenever you can do that. So I think that's the first point. I think the second one, just to build on what the minister was saying, look, ASEAN's power is in ASEAN, right? It's 10 countries, it's several trillion dollars of a GDP. And if we unlock the digital economy of ASEAN, it can create $1 trillion of incremental value, right? Simple way that all of you should think about it is that is pretty much your future. If you unlock the digital economy in ASEAN, but to be able to do that, it's very important, I think, to the point that was also made, is that we have free flow of information with the right set of governance models, integrated payment systems, again, which goes back to information, and really a harmonized set of regulations across these countries, right? Because if every country decides to kind of lock down, you pretty much have a whole set of small countries that have locked down. So by definition, not only are you going to impact small businesses and impact their growth and make it harder to start companies, but also the addressable market. See, ideally a Vietnamese startup or a Vietnamese company should instantly wake up in the morning and say, my addressable market is 660 million people and it's $2.5 to $3 trillion. Right? When you do that, all of a sudden, you're pretty much operating at massive scale from day zero. So I think we need to be very, very thoughtful about this topic, because sometimes, you know, we forget what's the real objective. The objective is to give you, as a consumer, control of your data.
Amrita, if I can just add a quick one to say that, you know, everybody has said it. I want to echo the fact that for ASEAN, this whole concept of data is the new oil, and how then do we get the greatest value out of this new commodity that doesn't get depleted? You know, I mean, that doesn't get depleted, right? I mean, data is the only commodity that gets better with time and with as it grows. But right now, the opportunity for ASEAN is really about to leapfrog and understand the optimization. And I think what Wabi Minister has mentioned, how do we optimize this data value at the same time, being able to balance it with the whole data governance. Now, the caution or the worry that I have is that data governance, I know that within the ASEAN, it's one of the five tracks in WEF ASEAN, but however, a lot of it is driven from ITU. And in ITU, I don't believe there is a track on ASEAN. So it's very much driven by the developed countries, where I think, like the minister says, I think going a little bit overboard when it comes to data governance. So I think we need to find our own flavor, ASEAN, otherwise it will be a lost opportunity.
Okay, now we have just about 5 minutes left in this session. So we also actually put out this session and asked people questions on Facebook, and I have a few questions. We'll take one last question from the audience, and maybe that gentleman right at the back, in a white shirt right at the back, if you take the microphone to him. And while the microphone is going, I'm just going to read out a few questions that people ask. Ethan Wang said, my concern is how do we compete globally? Kate Sukum said, as the US economy is entering a late cycle of growth expansion, would the possible recession greatly affect ASEAN? What are the pros and cons of growing presence of China in ASEAN countries? Amelia Kings, and ethical considerations should not be neglected, as I mentioned. Srey Prana, my question to ASEAN leaders, how do CLM countries enhance economic growth? And Radhan Sung, with increased importance of blockchain technology, we didn't talk about at all, in the supply chain, taking into account the technology advancement gaps across member states, what are the strategic plans to ensure that the technology will benefit ASEAN international trades and enhancing mobility? Okay, so those were the internet questions that we were not able to answer, but some of the questions were answered in what we were said. We'll take a last question from the gentleman at the back, and then we'll have final comments from the panel.
I have a question for you. That I know that when we join ASEAN group, I think that there are many countries combine, and that means that there are no boundary between country. And I think that there is many big company will join in Vietnam. So do you think that it's the advantage or disadvantage with the small business in Vietnam?
I think many of the panelists will agree that ASEAN collectively is stronger than as individual nations, but I'll let, in fact, Minh answer that. But since there's a gentleman right next to you also wants to ask, we'll take your question as well, and we'll get collectively Minh to answer them. Please ask your question. The gentleman in the blue shirt. Yeah.
Vâng, chúng tôi có thêm một câu hỏi này dành cho ba vị diễn giả đấy luôn ạ. Thứ nhất là xin được hỏi ông Rajan Anandan. Có thể nói rằng là như ông có nói ban đầu đấy ạ, Việt Nam thì là một dân số trẻ rất là tốt.
Have a very good young people and 50% of Southeast Asia create 50% of the GDP of the Southeast Asia, and Google is a very strong companies on AI and IR for IA. So now what Google is pay the attention to in ASEAN and in Vietnam in particular, do you have any mechanism to support the companies in ASEAN and in Vietnam? Second questions go to the Minister of Asia. You are supporting the government. So what are the support that Malaysian government pay for the SME and startup to follow the IR4IR? And the last question for Mr. Minh, you are the very successful startup. We have a very difficult for the startup, which is the capital. Do you have any advice for the startup to raise the fund and to collect, to call for the capital? Thank you.
One question, we've now got four questions. if you don't mind, Minister, do you mind if we just take 5 minutes over the session? If it's fine with the Minister, sorry about that. But these are important questions, and I think we'll start with you, Minh. If you can answer the last question the young man asked, as well as the earlier question that we heard.
Okay. Yeah, I got to ask this question a lot, you know. How to raise money, and you know, specifically, and in a way, it's a simple and difficult question to answer, because you know, you ask specifically and not generally, right? Because people are gonna often say that you know, you're gonna go to see VC, you're gonna raise money from friends and families, and so on and so forth. I think generally, from my own experience raising money, and in my own experience of seeing other people raising money, my answer may disappoint you. I think the best way of raising money is not to raise, but wait for people to give you money.
Yes.
Right?
Okay.
So basically, when you are so good that people like myself or Rajan say, please take my money, please. That is how you raise money.
Agree.
Of course, I mean, like, you know, if you are not, I mean, and I'm sure that in this World Economic Forum, there's many people, many startups that you may got to see later that they experience the same thing. So how to do that? And there will not be any specific answer to the word how, right? Because it really depends on you. But basically, the point being is, and I just make it simple, don't go ask for money, right? Do something that people want to give you money. That's how you're gonna get it. If you go ask for money, it can be painful, and it's not gonna work out.
Okay,
thank you.
Okay, Rajan, there was a question for you for Google.
We're doing a lot to try to support startups, right? And it ranges all the way from skilling, right? So we've got huge focus programs around helping, you know, whether it's mobile developers, skills in AI, ML, and so on. So that's at one end of the spectrum, which is skilling. Second, you know, we have a whole set of programs around cloud, around digital advertising, and so on and so forth, where we actually specifically focus and support startups. And third, we have a program called Launchpad Accelerator. You know, it's a
those of you that are building startups, and if you're interested in leveraging the best of Google, it's for early stage companies where we have a 6-month intensive period of mentoring with startups. We don't do it for a large number, we do it for a very small number of startups where we bring the best of Google engineering, product, sales, marketing, so on and so forth, and then it culminates with spending some time at our corporate head office in Mountain View. So it's really a range of things that we do, all the way from skilling developers to actually working with early stage companies. And then across ASEAN, we've also started investing in companies. So some of you may be familiar. We actually made an investment in a company called Gojek and several others. So it's really a range of things that we do to support startups. I open with this. We are incredibly excited about the entrepreneurial energy and the entrepreneurial passion in Vietnam.
Okay, and Minister Saddiq, there's a question for you as well on Malaysia.
Yeah. I personally believe it's not a great idea to micromanage the success and failures of startups. I'm a bigger fan of ensuring that we prepare a fertile ground for young people to then be well educated so that then they can have their own startups, because startups are independent, right? So I want to talk a lot more about creating that fertile ground. One is, I think, from the lowest of spectrums, is just to ensure that internet is accessible to as many people as possible. So while we have the great city of Kuala Lumpur, there are also areas in Malaysia in which internet access, especially 4G, is not the greatest. Or some areas where it is, at least there's a big cost barrier. So one thing the government is focusing on, the Minister of Communication, YB Gobind Singh, is to ensure that internet becomes more affordable and accessible. And one plan which we put forward in the next 2 years is to ensure that the cost of internet is slashed by 50% and internet speed is doubled. And that's one of the biggest KPIs which I believe he is looking into. Mm-hmm. That's one part. Because then when you do that, entrepreneurs will come out on their own. Interest from the internet will then develop your own independent startup communities. Secondly, is through education. That's why now we are ensuring that coding is made a subject in schools so that it can be taught to students as young as 8, 9, 10 years old. We have a lot of coding competitions run by the government and also by private sector to ensure that the interest in coding is also expanded. Furthermore, I also believe in using unconventional ways to achieve a conventional outcome, because to me that's all about young people. Wherever I travel, almost all the successful entrepreneurs who I've met, especially in the tech industry, usually start up their interest in playing video games. I mean, this is just one more which I just heard. I met the founder and CEO of Razer, and he said the exact same thing. Ming Liang. Yeah, Ming Liang. He started out by becoming a gamer. Look at some of the best, multi-billionaires. They all started with their interest partially due to that. So that's why I'm very keen, because it's not just about the youth ministry, it's also about the sports ministry, which is under my portfolio, which is to make esports very big. Yeah. I'm very keen on that. I mean, I'm competing with Singapore, with Vietnam. I know Minh will definitely try to capture the market. But in Malaysia, for example, half of our population are made up of gamers. I mean, I just met my bodyguard, and he's like about 40 to 50. And when he's free, I see him playing Mobile Legends. His children play Dota. At the same time, Malaysia, while only a population of 32 to 33 million, but in terms of gaming revenue, it's ranked 21st, much larger than some of the biggest economies. But why I'm interested in this, not about the gaming part, less about that, but the industry and the ancillary benefits in which we'll create. The interest and passion in not just becoming a gamer, but becoming a software developer, an IT developer. The passion and love into one's mobile phones, or specifically IT. I think if we are able to create that fertile ground and territory, which acts as a helicopter pad or a launch pad for more startups, I think in the end, the government doesn't need to micromanage. In the end, we will have successful entrepreneurs like Minh coming up, even without great government assistance, just by inspiring them and preparing the right ground, will move them forward. For more detailed explanation, We have the amazing MDEC director here, Dato' Yasmin, who's definitely leading that charge. So let's give some time for her to explain.
Dear audience, the challenge is that we are fighting against time at the moment. So I'm just going to ask Yasmin to, in 30 seconds, to give her final comment. And then I want Annie to end with the first I, identity, because we had one question about ASEAN as a whole and sovereign nations. So 30 seconds for you and 30 seconds for you, Annie.
It's amazing how the young minister learns to delegate so fast. But okay, just to wrap up, I guess, yeah? Sure. So, you know, I mean, for sure, this 4IR is real, it's coming. And either we, which end of the stick do we end at? You know, are we going to be disrupted? Are we going to be disruptees? So the role that the government, and I do agree that it's not, I think Minh you mentioned it, or Annie you mentioned it, it has to be a public-private. Government cannot micromanage, government cannot be too prescriptive about what needs to be done. Innovation is also about, you know, about creativity, right? So a few things that we need to do, like in Malaysia, YB minister mentioned, the minister mentioned the fact that infrastructure and a lot of ASEAN countries need to leapfrog in this. Malaysia has, apart from the, our minister has mentioned, has doubled the speed at half the price, but as well has gone to say that internet access to internet is a basic human right, and that we are, that he is actually pushing for this to be put into the constitution. Right, so I think that's number one. The second part is that skills, and you know, skills and skills and skills, investing in our young. This is so crucial, and this is something that the government, education, it's not about textbook, it's not about telling them exam-based, it's about curiosity, it's about projects, about problem-solving skills. And the last one is about, you know, to the young people, you are at such an interesting journey. I wish I'm young all over again. I wish, you know, I was right where you are coming in to the coming out of university with the world ahead of you. If ASEAN or if Vietnam is going to leapfrog in this, it's going to be driven by you. If you do not do it, then the rest of the people who are already in the workforce, are chances are they will be disrupted. So you will have to leapfrog. And how do you do it? You got to be a society of dreamers. And I always say this, dream the big dreams to solve the impossible problems.
Lovely. Thank you very much, Yasmin. That's very inspiring. And thank Annie, you. A final word for you as
very,
we started.
Very good. Thank you. I get to say the last word. I think the idea of identity actually came from the global shapers. So the fact that we have 75 startups showcasing on this platform today is great. So how do we get there? I think the identity can only be built if you know purpose and passion. I think Minh talked about magic. The reason why he has the magic is he has a passion. We need to be here now on a good common purpose. And we cannot do this alone. So we need partnerships. And that's why we are on this stage, because we believe that the public-private partnership can make this happen. And the last one is, not because Google is here, platforms. ASEAN is a platform. So come on this platform. Come together with the governments, with the companies, and all of us can make a better, bigger, a safer ASEAN together. Thank you.
Thank you very much. That's so wonderful. So a final word from me, and I want to thank all of you very much for being here, especially the students as well as the public, because the whole aim of this exercise was to open up the forum to new ideas, to share with you the new insights that these experts have. And you know, it's been a lot of talking. We've all been sitting here and talking. And maybe some of the stuff was a bit academic. But I hope for the students particularly, that there were some ideas which you took away from this discussion. Things about passion, things about dreaming, things about magic. These are all wonderful words. I hope in some way they have inspired you to a better future. Because, you know, I heard the two things I want to share with you. One of them is dream, but dream with your eyes open. And the other thing that I heard is that when opportunity knocks at your door, open it. So I hope that we've opened some doors for you today in terms of ideas, in terms of inspiration. We have a very inspirational panel here. So I want to thank the minister very much for being here. Thank you very much, Minister. And I want to thank all of you in the audience, and especially I want to thank my wonderful panelists. Thank you very much. A big hand to all of you and to the panel.
Thank you.
Yes, maybe we should take a photo from your side.
And all of you, I hope you've got your copy of this. I have one copy here, and Minh had said I should give it to the person who asked the best question. But Minh, there were so many good questions. Can I give my copy to you? He doesn't need it, but I would like to give it as a tribute, as an inspiration of Vietnamese startups. May I give this copy to you?
Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. Thanks, Saddiq. Lovely to have you. Thank you, Rajan. And thanks, Yasmin. Minister, can we have you on the stage and have a photograph with you? Thank you very much. Thank you. Please come and join us.